Hello, I'm Ben Godwin. Welcome to the Word Workshop, recorded at the Good Springs Full Gospel Church.
God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy.
My wife Michelle and I have pastored the Good Springs Full Gospel Church since 1999, a Spirit-filled church with a hunger for God and a heart for people. Good Springs Full Gospel Church is located in Walker County on Highway 269, 10 miles south of Jasper.
The prophet said that the knowledge of the glory of the Lord will cover the earth as the waters cover the sea.
So prepare your hearts to receive from the Word, because when all else fails, God's Word works.
Hallelujah. Welcome in. I want you to go with me in your Bibles, if you will, please, to 1 Samuel chapter number 30. 1 Samuel chapter number 30, and we will get there momentarily. I want to show you a couple things I found interesting. I like this statement: your ministry is often found where you've been broken. Think about that. If you've been through something, you've earned the right to help somebody else. Amen. That's where your ministry is. How about this? Stop looking for the perfect church. Go worship a perfect God today with a congregation of flawed people who need grace as much as you do. How many admit I need grace? A heaping helping. Amen. Of grace. This made me laugh. Daniel slept in a lion's den. Peter slept in a prison. Jesus slept in a storm on the boat. So no matter what your circumstance, you can take a nap. God can give you peace. Somebody posted this: I'm so Pentecostal, I won't even eat pizza unless it's delivered. I'm glad you've been delivered. Saved, delivered. Hallelujah. I think Val posted this one: when the devil thought he had you, but Jesus came and grabbed you. Take that, devil. Hallelujah. Amen. How about this? As you know, it was Groundhog Day. Was it Tuesday or whenever? Many false prophets shall rise and deceive many. And somebody posted this: I ain't nothing but a groundhog lying all the time. He's a rodent, not a meteorologist, folks. So I don't put too much stock in what happens up in Puxatawney. Anyway, did you see the one about Florida? An alligator comes out and sees his shadow. Well, it's good to laugh, isn't it? I want to use for a subject today, Ziklag, David's full recovery. Ziklag, David's full recovery. I believe it's high time for God's people to fully recover what the enemy has stolen from them. I was reading this passage this week and meditating on it, praying about it, and thinking about preaching on it. And when we got Elizabeth's book in the mail, I opened it up and I read the foreword, which is by Brother Mike Shreve. And interestingly enough, his foreword is on 1 Samuel 30 about Ziklag and what happened there with David and his men. I said, thank you, Lord. That's confirmation. Praise the Lord. I don't think that was a coincidence. I think it was confirmation. By the way, Einstein said coincidence is God's way of remaining anonymous. He was pretty smart for a genius, wasn't he? Praise God. There are four parts to this message or this story: the raid, the refuge, the resource, and the recovery. If you're taking notes, the raid, the refuge, the resource, and the recovery. And we'll tackle each one individually. But let's read a few verses here in 1 Samuel chapter 30. Starting with verse 1, New King James says, "Now it happened when David and his men came to Ziklag on the third day that the Amalekites had invaded the south, and Ziklag attacked Ziklag and burned it with fire, and had taken captive the women and those who were there, from small to great. They did not kill anyone, but carried them away and went their way. So David and his men came to the city, and there it was, burned with fire. And their wives, their sons, and their daughters had been taken captive. Imagine. Verse 4, then David and the people who were with him lifted up their voices and wept until they had no more power to weep. Have you ever cried so much you just couldn't cry anymore? Verse 5, David's two wives, he was only had two at this time, he got more later. Two wives, Ahinoam the Jezreelite and Abigail the widow of Nabal the Carmelite, had been taken captive. Verse 6, now David was greatly distressed, for the people spoke of stoning him, because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and his daughters. Say it with me if you're there, but David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. How many are going to encourage yourself in the Lord today? Let's pray. Lord, bless the reading of your word. Lord, just let something leap off of the page. Let it be relevant, practical, applicable to our lives. Lord, help me to say something of eternal value today, something meaningful that will minister life to everyone that's here and those that watch by video. We give you praise and glory. When we leave this place, may we say within our hearts, we have heard from God. In Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen and amen. Let's talk first about the raid. Everybody say the raid. 1 through 5 talks about the raid. Ziklag was a city given to David by King Achish. He was a Philistine king of Gath, Goliath's hometown. He gave this city to David for he and his 600 men and their families to inhabit while they were hiding and running from King Saul. This blew my mind as I was studying this. David ran and hid from King Saul for about 8 years. Can you imagine being a fugitive for 8 years? Always looking over your shoulder, always wondering if there's some assassin lurking about. For 8 years. He ran from King Saul. About half of that time, he used Ziklag as his military base, his camp, his headquarters, if you will. We read here that the Amalekites ransacked and looted and burned Ziklag, David's city. His two wives, Ahinoam and Abigail, were taken hostage along with his men's wives and children. Then, when you think it couldn't get any worse, David's own men turned mutinous against him, blaming him for the disaster. How many know when things go wrong, people are always looking for somebody to blame? They want to know whose fault it is, looking for a scapegoat. Well, here God had used David to deliver all these men, and now they're turning on him. This is a bad situation, friends. The old saying, Murphy's Law, what can go wrong will go wrong. Things could not possibly get any worse. This is a major crisis in David's life. I would describe it as a train wreck. The wheels have fallen off. It's a total unmitigated disaster, a dumpster fire, if you will. This is a big mess. But how many know God can get you out of big messes? Look at somebody say, I serve a mighty God. He specializes in impossible situations. Impossibilities with men are opportunities to God. Aren't you glad you serve a mighty God today? So when life goes wrong, don't go wrong with it. Keep the right spirit. David could have pitched a fit. David could have said, forget this. I'm not putting up with this mess. I quit. I'm out of here. And he would have missed out on a huge blessing that God had in store for him just around the corner. Hallelujah. Remember, when the devil starts messing, the Lord starts blessing. Praise God. Remember, when the devil and the enemy hits you the hardest, hold on. You can count on it. You're on the brink of a breakthrough. Don't give up on the brink of a miracle. Now, let's talk about Ziklag for just a minute. That's a strange word, but I want to show you some of the meaning behind Ziklag. Ziklag means a winding or a bending. And I thought of that phrase, you may bend, but don't break. The enemy wants to break you. You can bend, but don't break. Amen. And then notice this, Ziklag also means to press someone or something to reveal what's inside of them. Like you would squeeze an orange, like you would squeeze a grape, or you would squeeze an olive. Those fruits have to be squeezed or crushed in order for the juice to be released. I mean, sometimes God will apply or allow pressure to be applied to us to test us and see what's really in our heart. God knows how to apply the pressure so that we realize we have nowhere else to run but to Him. He is our source. Hallelujah. So that's the raid. Now let's look at the refuge. Look what it says here again in verse 6. But David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. Another version says, David found strength in the Lord his God. God was David's refuge. When everything was going wrong, he ran to God. That's where we need to run. Amen? Don't run from God, run toward God. Praise God. So what do you do? Where do you turn when everything and everybody is against you? Circumstantially, there was nothing positive going on in David's life at this time. It was all negative news. When nothing in life was encouraging, he focused his attention on his mighty God, not on his miserable circumstances. Let me give you a scripture here, Psalm 23:13. I would have fainted, he said, unless I believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Every day we have a choice. We can choose to look at the badness of our circumstance, or we can choose to look at the goodness of God. I don't know about you, I'm going to focus on the goodness of God. You can look at what's going on in the world and be depressed, or you can look at what a mighty God you serve and have the joy of the Lord as your strength. Hallelujah! What happened to Peter when he took his eyes off Jesus? Blub, 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 blub. Peter, you know, we kind of fault him for failing, but he was the only one that had the guts to get out of the boat. He ought to be applauded. Lord, if it's you, bid me to come to thee. And here he comes out, whoa, walking on the water. Praise God. But when he took his eyes off Jesus and he started looking at the wind and the waves and the storm and all of the ominous clouds, he took his eyes off Jesus and he sank. The same is true for us. If you get your eyes off Jesus, you will sink. Hallelujah. But the Bible says, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despised the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Says, consider him who endured such contradiction of sinners, lest you be weary and faint in your mind. If you get your eyes off Jesus, you're going to faint. But if you focus on him, you'll stay strong. Hallelujah. So what did David do when everything went wrong? He kept his eyes on God. Hallelujah. We have a refuge we can run to. Look at this scripture. I love it. Psalm 46:1. God is our refuge. Say it with me. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. I'm glad to know God's not farther away when I'm in trouble. It says he's a present help. To me, that means he's closer than ever before. You remember the poem about footprints? The guy looking at the beach and he saw two sets of footprints. And then all of a sudden, there's only one set of footprints. And he questioned God. He said, Lord, why? He noticed that was the hardest times of his life. God, why? Why, when I was going through the most troubling times in my life, would you abandon me? God said, I didn't abandon you. It was then I carried you. Underneath are the everlasting arms. Hallelujah. The word translated encouraged here in verse 6 is interesting. It means to fasten to cleave to lay hold or to seize, to attach yourself. If you're going to encourage yourself in the Lord, you've got to attach yourself to him. The best illustration I could think of is the remora. You've seen these, I'm sure, on Animal Planet or Shark Week or something. You see these big sharks, they're just cruising along in the water, and then you have these parasite fish. They're called remoras. You've seen them? They have a suction cup on the top of their head, and they attach themselves to that shark. They get a hold of something bigger than themselves. I hope you hear what I'm saying. Lord, I hope you don't mind. I'll be a parasite. Hallelujah. I just want to attach myself to you because I can't handle these problems, but I know you can. You're bigger than I am. Hallelujah. How many know we serve a mighty God today? Angels bow before him. Heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty God we serve. Psalm 61:2. When my heart is overwhelmed, David said, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Psalm 61:2, I love that. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Look at this scripture with me, if you will, please. Proverbs 18:10, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and are safe. So when the battle is bigger than you are, run to the God who's bigger than the battle. I posted it on Facebook last night. Stop telling people how big your mountain is and start telling your mountain how big your God is. Woo, hallelujah. I need to say that again for somebody to really get it. Stop telling people how big your mountain is and start telling your mountain how big your God is. Who are you, O great mountain? Before my God, you'll become a plain. Hallelujah. It's not by might. It's not by power. It's by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. So David had a refuge, and you've got the same refuge you can run to. And then notice the next little section. David had a resource. Two, actually, but I want to read it. Look at verse 7. And David said to Abiathar the priest, Ahimelech's son, bring me the ephod here to me. And Abiathar brought the ephod to David. So David inquired of the Lord, saying, shall I pursue this troop? Shall I overtake them? And he answered him, pursue, for you shall surely overtake them, and without fail, do you see it? Recover what? How many believe in for a full recovery? So David went, he and his 600 men who were with him, came to the brook Bezor, where those stayed who were left behind. But David pursued, he and 400 men, for 200 stayed behind, who were too faint or weary that they could not cross the brook Bezor. I want you to notice David had a resource. He had two resources. He had a priest, Abiathar, and he had prayer. Those are two of your greatest resources. By the way, Abiathar was the son of Ahimelech. You remember last week I preached about how David ran to Nob, to Ahimelech, who gave him Goliath's sword and gave him the showbread. Well, guess what happened? When Saul heard that he had aided and abetted David, who was a fugitive, he sent his soldiers in. They killed 85 of the priests, plus the women and children in that town. That shows you how backslidden King Saul was. How mad and insane he was with jealousy. But Abiathar escaped. And Abiathar, you'll read over and over, was consulting with David. He became like his personal pastor. So whenever David had a spiritual issue or a dilemma in his life, he would turn to Abiathar. He had a resource. He had a priest he could go to. How many are glad you've got a priest you can go to? I'm not talking about a preacher or a pastor. Hallelujah. I'm talking about your great high priest. Your great high priest who ever lives to make intercession for you. Bible said he was tempted in all points like as we are, yet without sin. He can relate to whatever you're going through. You've got a resource. And the other resource was, notice this. He said, bring me the ephod. What is an ephod? I'm glad you asked. I'm going to tell you. Hallelujah. An ephod was a vest-like apron worn by the priest, this blue part of the outfit there. It was like an apron that the priest wore, and they did it. They wore it when they were offering sacrifices, burning incense, whatever their official duties were, praying, interceding for the people. They would wear this ephod. It was a sacred, holy garment. And David said, you bring it to me. And what he's really saying is, listen, when everything's going wrong, it's time to pray. There are some situations you cannot change any other way but to pray about it. You can try. You'll be beating your head against a wall. There are some battles you can only win in the Spirit. There are some victories you can only win through prayer, my friend. Hallelujah. And so what does David say? I've got a resource. I've got a priest I can run to, and I've got a God I can pray to. Hallelujah. He had a resource, and you've got the same resource today. Praise the Lord. When you don't know what to do, pray, and God will show you what to do. Prayer is our greatest resource. It taps into a supernatural power source. Prayer should be our first resource, not our last resort. A lot of people do everything else and then pray last. Why don't we start praying first? Pray first. Some people, I've said it many times, treat God like the paramedics. They only call when they have an emergency. Help! Nothing wrong with calling on God when you got an emergency, but if you call on him all the time, you'll have fewer emergencies. Hallelujah. I love you, folks. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry what? Everything to God in prayer. Did you notice this in verse 10? That a third of David's men, 200 out of the 600, were too faint to fight. Just think about what these men have been through. Their city has been burned. They've just come back from a military mission. They're exhausted. They're drained mentally, emotionally, They're just burned out. And not only that, their wives and their children have been taken hostage. Can you imagine the mental anguish, the emotional distress that these men are in? And they're too faint to even cross over a bridge to go and try to get their stuff back. Have you ever got there where you were just weary with the battle? You felt like you were drained and you couldn't do anything else. You couldn't even lift a foot to take another step. Well, let me give you a scripture. I got a scripture for you this morning. If you ever feel like that, Isaiah 40, 29 through 31. He gives power to the faint, and to those who have no might, he increases strength. You say, oh, I'm young. I'm tough. I can handle it. Yeah, the next verse says, even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But I love verse 31, and you know it. They that wait upon the Lord. I said, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as an eagle. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Hallelujah. When you get in God's presence, hallelujah, it will energize you and give you strength you need to overcome. Quit fighting the battle in your own strength. That's right. Yeah. The battle is not yours. The battle is the Lord's. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. I grew up on a lake, as you know, down in Florida. And we often had canoes and other little, we called them John boats, to go fishing in or whatever. And man, it's, you get out there on a windy day and you're trying to paddle that thing across the lake and... It's like trying to shovel snow in a blizzard. You're not making any progress. Let me make it real practical for you parents. It's like trying to clean house when the kids are home. Huffing and puffing and straining. I'm going to get across this. Boy, how happy I was when Dad got us a little outboard. Hallelujah. Praise God. That's Christians. A lot of Christians, they're struggling in their own strength to win their battles. When if they would just tap into the supernatural power source. Woo, hallelujah. You got a source of power you don't even realize. Because you've got a great high priest and you've got the resource of prayer. Hallelujah. You have not because you. Look at somebody say, start asking. Start asking. The good thing about trouble is it makes you pray. God allowed a Ziklag crisis sometimes. He forced David to his knees, and sometimes God will allow it to force us to our knees. Look at this. One of my favorite quotes by Abraham Lincoln said this, many times I have been driven to my knees with the overwhelming realization I had nowhere else to go. Where could I go but to the Lord? He's your resource. Doctors might be able to help you, but they're limited. Lawyers might be able to help you, but they're limited. Bankers might be able to help you, but they're limited. Psychologists and psychologists might be able to help you, but they're limited. A preacher might be able to help you, but he or she is limited. But let me tell you something about God. He is unlimited. Hallelujah. People might be able to help you. I know for sure he can help you and he will help you. Tap into your power source. Glory to God. Prayer moves the hand that moves the world. Use your greatest resource. Hallelujah. Now let's talk about the last section here, the recovery. Look down at verse 16, if you will, please. And when it brought him down, there they were spread out, the Amalekites, all over the land, eating and drinking and dancing. Man, they're having a big party because they just won this battle. They've got all the spoils from David's city. Because of all the great spoil which they had taken from the land of the Philistines and from the land of Judah. David attacked them from twilight unto the evening of the next day. Not a man of them escaped except for 400 young men who rode on camels and fled. Verse 18, say it with me. So David recovered how much? Say it again. So David recovered all that the Amalekites had carried away. And David rescued his two wives. And nothing of theirs was lacking, either small or great, sons or daughters, spoil or anything which they had taken from them. Say it again. David recovered all. Somebody grab a hold of this today. I believe you're gonna take back everything the devil has stolen from you and your family and your house and your life. Hallelujah. Look at somebody and say, I'm believing for a full recovery. It wasn't a partial recovery, it was a full recovery. God is going to restore what the enemy has stolen from you. Look at verse 20. Then David took all the flocks and herds they had driven before those livestock and said, listen, this is David's spoil. I read that and I started laughing in my office. Amalekites, you think this is yours, but it doesn't belong to you. God gave it to me. It belongs to me. Hallelujah. I love that old song. You've heard it. We hadn't sung it in a long time. I went to the enemy's camp and I took back what he stole from me. Somebody needs to say that this morning. I went to the enemy's camp. Come on. And I took back what he stole from me. He's under my feet. He's under my feet. Satan is under my feet. Quit telling everybody the devil's on your back. He doesn't belong on your back. He belongs under your feet. Hallelujah. Through the power of Jesus' name, through the power of the Holy Ghost, and by the blood of Jesus Christ, he is defeated in Jesus' name. Glory to God. The thief comes to what? Steal, kill, and destroy. Satan may have stolen your health. He may have stolen your peace. He may have stolen your joy. He may have stolen your victory. He may have stolen your purity. He may have stolen your finances, your relationships, your praise, your passion for God. He may have stolen all those things or some of those things, but I know one thing, God can retrieve them. He can give you a full recovery in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. David is a type of Christ who spoiled Satan on the cross. See, the gospel promises and provides a full recovery of what Adam lost in the very beginning. I believe when we get to heaven, in the resurrection, I believe we're going to have everything Adam lost that he had with God in the beginning, but then even more so is going to be added. See, right now we have a partial restoration, a partial recovery because of the cross. But one day there's going to be a full recovery, a full restoration. Woo, hallelujah. Let me give you a scripture. It talks about what Jesus did on the cross here. Colossians 2:15, having spoiled principalities and powers, meaning demonic forces, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it, in the cross. You know what it means to spoil an enemy? It means to strip them or to plunder their valuables. And Jesus, hallelujah, when he died, he gave up the ghost. The Bible said his spirit went into the lower parts of the earth. That's where he took back the keys of death, hell, and the grave. Hallelujah. Let me give you another scripture that ties in. Ephesians 4, 8 and 9 says, when he ascended on high, he led captivity captive and he gave gifts to men. Now he ascended, what is he also descended into the lower parts of the earth. The imagery is of a victorious military general. Can you see? They go out to battle with their troops. And when they come back and there's this big parade and everybody's, you know, woo, happy and celebrating. And what do? They take the spoils of war and they give them to their fellow citizens, to their fellow soldiers. Hallelujah. Praise God. Jesus spoiled the devil through the cross and he gave us the prize. Hallelujah. He gave gifts to men. Thank God for all of the blessings that we enjoy because of the cross. Again, right now we only enjoy partial restoration, but I believe the day of total restoration is coming. Just like David and his men won the victory and recovered all, Christ and his angels and saints have won the victory, and we're going to enjoy a full recovery. Let me close with this. If you're looking at your circumstance today and everywhere you look, it looks negative, do this. Encourage yourself in the Lord. Your bank account may be discouraging, but encourage yourself in the Lord. Your doctor's report may be discouraging, but encourage yourself in the Lord. What's going on in your family, your home may be discouraging, but encourage yourself in the Lord today. I prophesy to somebody today, you are going to recover all in Jesus' name. I said, you're going to recover all in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Come on, stand on your feet with me and give God some glory and praise in this house. Hallelujah. He's mighty to save. He's mighty to heal. He's mighty to deliver. He's mighty to restore. I want us to sing that chorus, honey. He's mighty to save. Hallelujah. That's the kind of God we serve today. If you want or need prayer. Hello everyone, this is Pastor Ben Godwin, thanking you for watching our broadcast today. I pray it has been a blessing and a source of spiritual enrichment for you and your family. I'd like to invite you to visit and subscribe to our YouTube channel, where you can view many more singing and preaching videos. Search for Good Springs Full Gospel Church at youtube.com. Also, please visit our website at goodspringsfgc.org. where you can learn more about our church and ministry, read many of my articles on a variety of subjects, find a direct link to our YouTube channel, shop our online store, and donate to our church and help support our TV ministry with debit, credit card, or PayPal. Also, you can mail in an offering the old-fashioned way to Good Springs Full Gospel Church, P.O. Box 3161, Jasper, Alabama 35502. We can assist you in any way in your spiritual journey. Please contact us. And remember, when all else fails, God's word works.